Welcome to The Younger Me, a 10-part interview video series where we feature some of our very own VetTech alumni students who are currently working in various professional fields. We hope that these videos will give you a glimpse of the possibilities after you graduate for you to set bigger and bolder goals. Enjoy.
Hi everyone, welcome to today's episode for our series The Younger Me. So today we have Mr. Oliver with us. He is currently a TP lecturer and has continued his master degree from NTU, and he was an alumni of TP Biotech. Let's welcome Mr. Oliver here with us today. Yay! Okay, Mr. Oliver, do you want to tell us more about yourself?
Hi everyone. I'm quite honored to get interviewed in this Dear Younger Me series. My name is Oliver. I joined Temasek Poly as a lecturer for around 2 years. So currently I'm teaching in the diploma in vet tech.
What do you do after TP? Which universities you went to, and what were your main research and studies about?
When I graduated from Temasek Poly, from this course called the diploma in biotech, which is now no longer exists, after I graduated from Temasek Poly, I go to the army lah. I went to the army to serve my national service. After which, I actually got a job, a lab assistant in NUS. Okay, working in a medical research lab. Yeah. So that is my first job after I graduate and finish NS. I'm quite blessed. It's because it's very smooth, you know. After finish the NS, straight away, you know, within a month, I got a job, right? So there is no gap for me. Yeah, so I start work with a diploma from TP. Right? Yeah. So that's how I done my first, I think I spent about 1-2 years. Yes, because it's contract work. Yeah, it's a contract work. I learned a lot in NUS, and then further, I work with animals. There's a time where I work with a lot of lab animals, such as rats, mouse, and even swine. Yes, because we are doing some research in diabetes. Okay, then after that, it gave me the interest to further studies, because I do found that, you know, if I want to get more knowledge in this medical science, biomedical science, that time still don't have, you know, in TP, yeah. Then I got a degree. Yeah. So I go to this place called the UK, Bradford University, and get my biomedical science. Yeah, with honors, right? So that is how I get into the uni. Lah. So from getting to the biomedical science, after graduate from the university, then I try to work in a research lab, but during that time, there's no opportunity lah, open for a research lab, right? So that time, I joined, that time is my first step, I joined into education line. So I started my first teaching in ITE, ITE College East, where they run a course in biotech or medical tech. Yeah, so I've been there teaching. Quite a glance, after teaching for about 7 years, then I move on to Republic Poly. So during the period when I was ITE, I actually do a part-time study. So I want to further upgrade myself. So I seek for different opportunities because I want to stay in Singapore. So I want to study local. So that time, there's opportunity for me to study NTU to get a master, right? So it's a master's of life science. I choose on marine conservation, marine. Yeah, then after which I got my master's, I proceed to teach in Republic Poly. Yeah, so I spent Republic Poly also quite for some time, about 6 years like that. Then I came back to my mother's school, Temasek Poly here, to teach. But of course, biotech already gone. So I mean that with my experience working with animals as well as, you know, my research in conservation, I think vet tech fit me in this, yeah, for me to teach. Yeah.
With that being said, right, what made you want to return to TP and choose the education line over, let's say, like researching in like the labs and other, you know, other opportunities? Like, what made you want to come back to TP and be a lecturer?
Actually, many years ago, when I was in RP, I was actually invited to come back to TP. But that time, I was already working in RP. So I would like to, you know, since I'm in RP, let me, you know, learn and experience, you know, teaching young adults. Okay. Then coming to TP is also one of my call, because TP is my main mother school, right? And then I mean that it is very fun and miraculously type of relation while working with your teacher. I have a few teachers still here. Healthy and senior now, right? I'm working with them, even in the same module. We are in the same team. So basically it is that I see them as a mentor. Now I see them as a colleague. So it's a very unique relationship, right, whereby, you know, you are able to work in your own school.
What made you choose the education sector? Okay.
Actually, my dream job is to become a teacher. Basically, all the while, I just want to become a teacher. Since secondary two or sec three, if I'm not wrong, I can't remember, I've been inspired by a few of my form teacher in the secondary school. And, you know, then I always want to know, you know, how it feels like to become a teacher. Right, so that is my sparks when I want to become a teacher. But you may want to ask me then why I, after diploma, why I don't want to, you know, become a teacher. I think that time there's a very different type of opportunity for you to join MOE. I think maybe the selection is more stringent. Okay, and maybe that time the teachers are not in demanding. So it's quite difficult to get into the MOE. So that's why that's why I joined the research area first. But after that, as I told you, IT have opportunity for me to become an educator. So from that onwards, I become an educator until now.
Would you say that like you enjoy seeing your students grow and learn and like in a way being a mentor to them, like how your teachers were to you, right?
That's what yes, mm-hmm. Correct. Okay. Correct. So in this education line, I actually want to see students actually getting the knowledge is one thing, but there's one thing I find very important is that I want to see my student from what they don't know what to do, in the end to know what they want to do. That is the most satisfying, motivating feeling for me. Because since teaching start from ITE, I have seen students who actually have that aim. They become entrepreneurs, they become businessmen, you know. When they get married, they invite me, you know. So these are the, you know, it's the after school relationship. It's the after school relationship that actually I cherish this type of thing. Yeah, so this is also part of me, you know, why I want to work in education.
So what qualities do you think it takes to be a great educator, and what do you learn from your past teachers that, you know, that you hope that other, you know, the future lecturers and educators should have?
I think lecturer doesn't mean that you are the cleverest and you know everything. I don't think so. We are all human. I also learning. Sometimes I even learn from the students, you know. So I don't think that, you know, of course you have a certain level of knowledge in order to impart the skills. But I think the most important is the heart of the educator, right? I think the heart is very important. So whatever things you do to the student, it is the best of heart for that student. Even sometimes students may misunderstand your actions or the way you speak. But I think the heart is important. Those people who want to become educator, I can advise that don't rashly join to become an educator, right? Think properly whether you have that heart to do. An educator is like a nurse, same. You know, joining as a nursing career is also, you know, it's not just join for a few months that you quit, you know. It's a special calling. Yeah.
Mr. Oliver, just now you said that you wanted to be an educator. So what made you want to be an educator regarding marine conservation and biodiversity in Singapore?
So actually, part of my hobbies is to aquarium. I keep aquarium, I keep marine fish last time, as well as I like diving. So I'm the person who loves nature. So during that time when I'm taking my mastery course, I was thinking if I can actually use my passions and what I know about the world and learn from the technical knowledge in the mastery level, I think it will be very helpful to me. So from that onwards, it actually sparked me from a biomedical area into marine conservation. Yeah. So from there onwards, I started a lot of things related to marine conservation in aquaculture. I think that time was, I was very active in this area, especially in when I was in Republic Poly.
What's so interesting about this field of interest? It's if you had one thing that you want the public to know about ecology, about marine conservation, what would it be?
Basically, in our local context, biodiversity, the nature, everything is actually quite hidden because of our urban city. And the focus area of most working people may not be in this area because Singapore growth is much more in shipping, business, commercial, retail, tourism. However, as part of a small island in Singapore, we are very blessed with a lot of corals which nobody knows, especially in the coastal and the southern islands of Singapore. And they are actually worth to be protected. So marine conservation is a very niche area in Singapore. And recently, because Singapore is moving towards the sustainability, this area has been picked up, has been broadcast by the media. And then more and more people, even the young children, also know a little bit more about the conservation. That's why Singapore have a lot of wetlands, Sungai Buloh wetlands, Lorong Halus wetlands. So these are public, open to public to know more about this marine conservation. So this is actually a good time that, for the young people, you are very keen in loving the nature, take a step forward to actually learn more about this and how we can do to help to protect them. Right, institution, like Poly, in Temasek Poly, we can impart you the skills and the technical knowledge, right? But it's still the same thing. When we come to conservation, it's a heart, right? You need to have a heart to save the animal, to save the environment, and you should don't mind the dirty work, hot weather, warm weather. I have experience, working with horseshoe crab when there's thunderstorm. I have to call my student to come back because the lightning is there already, but my student, the passion is overdriving. He ignore my command. I have to go there and drag that out from the mud, because they are so passionate in at counting the horseshoe crab because they found a horseshoe crab nursery. So they are actually counting them, but the thunderstorm is coming, Yeah. So these are the thing, the passion, but of course we have to do it safely, right? This is a bad example. Yeah.
That's so adorable though. Any horseshoe crab fun facts you can give us?
I've been working with horseshoe crab for, for around 3 years. There's 4 species of horseshoe crab in the world. Singapore have 2. So Singapore have 50%, a unique small island, but we got 2 species, right? There's a big one and a small one. The bigger one are the marine, smaller one are the freshwater. That time when I do the research, we noticed that the marine one had the capability to swim across channel, from Pasir Ris to Chek Jewak, means the Pulau Ubin side. They have stronger swimming appendages compared to the freshwater. Freshwater are those the ones all stuck around Sungai Buloh. Yeah. And then fun fact about horseshoe crab is that they are fossil animal. It means that they have been exist with us for millions of years since the dinosaurs age. And to let you all know that their blood is blue in color and their blood have very powerful antibacterial property. Okay, so that's why it has been widely harvested for medical use. That's why they need to be protected.
Any other wild stories?
Yeah, that one may not. I think that one is pertaining to some other research. It's not horseshoe crab. That's what we are doing with the NParks, with doing the Pulau Ubin coastline. So there was this girl who stepped into the mud and we found that it's a quicksand, something like quicksand. So she sinks all the way to her chest. Then we have to pull her out. So 5 of us have to pull her, like pulling a carrot out from the mud. because she is a bit blessed with the size, that size, and then we drag her. So in the end, she has no shoes left because the shoe all stuck in there. We are so lucky that she's still wearing her pants lah, or else the whole pants and shoe may stuck in her mouth, you know? Yeah. So, you know, so she get very dirty, but she don't feel very sad, you know? She's very positive. She's very sure that this can be, this one can be a mud spa for me, a mud spa, right? Yeah. So that what's happened in Pulau Ubin was quite a, you know, quite a memorial period lah. We all were loving at that time. Yeah. And she tried to pull us in also, but we avoid lah. Even teacher, she also don't spare, you know, want to pull me inside, you know. And lucky I jump away a bit further. Yeah. So these are the, you know, very interesting things, you know, that and when we do coastal survey, yeah, coastal survey, these are the things that we can, you know, we can meet them. Other than conservation, I also would like to share is that I also taking part in working in a zoo. I think I share with some of my students that working in a zoo is always quite fun. Zoo is a mixture of conservation plus veterinary, right? So I work with penguins. I call their names, they will come to me. Very, very obedient, you know, very tame penguin. But not only that, lah, calling their name is one thing, but we need to make sure that the nutrition is well segregated to all the penguins. So the vet will give us a menu that we have to feed them accordingly. So calling our names, they will come to prevent other penguins come and snatch the food. Yeah. So I work with the animals, you know, working with them, you know, and learn about their behavior of this. So actually, it's also it's a good learning curve for me.
Like. Talking about your teaching journey and like your students, right? What sort of challenges do you face in your teaching journey?
There's a lot of challenges. Yeah, a lot of challenges. I think the main thing of a life of a teacher is that we are not here to please everyone. So that is the main thing I would like to share, that we are not here to please everyone, and the things that we do may not get very good feedback for everyone. So one of the challenges is that student may not understand what we as teacher will want to do this and do that, right? So this is such one of challenges. And of course, I have met very challenging moments when discussing issue with the parents, right? I think this is also one of the main challenges of all the teachers, even in primary school, you know, in up to even to the poly, right? We also have this type of issue. And of course, as a teacher, we not only care about academic, sometimes we also have to deal with things happening outside the school, right? So if the parents or the students come and seek for help, then I also will try my best to help them. But that is outside the school curriculum. Yeah, so these are the challenge. And then teachers, it's not a 9 to 5 p.m. job, right? I also receive quite a lot of queries and, you know, follow-up even after office hour. So this is also part of the challenge.
Let's go back a little bit when you were talking about your education and what you did after TP. So how did your biotech diploma in TP help you with your further studies? And why do you choose to pursue like conservation instead of continuing with the biotech route?
First one I want to answer is that how the diploma helped me. The diploma gave me a very good foundation, okay, of touching all the different areas in science, in biotech science, including the biomedical. So it gave me a choice to which of the area I would like to go to. And during that time, Singapore is picking up biotechnology research, and that is actually a golden era for our period of time. And getting a job is not a problem. And then because of the diploma that we have, right, we have a better understanding what will be the job scope of the job that we apply. Yeah, of course we were not able to apply all that we learned, but but it gives us a stronger training background before we engage into the real world. So the second question you asked me why I choose conservation, I think that's not I already answered that. It's because the mastery course that I took, right, it doesn't have any more related to the biomedical or what. Yeah. So that is the reason why you know, I choose the marine conservation because I am a aquarium hobbyist also.
Is it necessary for students who are looking to be a lecturer in polys or like the tertiary level to get to enter NIE and go through formal teaching training in order for you to be a lecturer, or is it, or are there like any other pathways that will help these students?
It's a school to train people to become a teacher, but under the Ministry of Education regulations, primary school till junior college, all teachers required to go to NIE. Okay, IHL, the higher learning, such as the polytechnic and university, doesn't require to for y'all to go to NIE. So that is a clear cut. Because of the regulations set by MOE. So basically, you know, even the lecturer that y'all are now, you know, y'all know in the poly, right? They are not, we are not from NIE. Yes, because polytechnic more focused on experience, technical experience, working industry experience. Yeah, so and that's why the primary school till the junior college is much more of academic pedagogy, more on the teaching style.
If you are under MOE, so all the way up to secondary school and JC, you have to go to NIE. But let's say you want to go to tertiary poly and IT, it doesn't require you to go to NIE.
Yeah. So basically, I think the polytechnic look for more on industry. So I'm not sure about fresh graduate are able to come to the poly to teach or not. That one depend on the poly during the recruitment time, lah, what they require. Lah. Yeah. So normally I will advise, you know, people that maybe you want to go to, really want to come and teach in the poly. Maybe you want to go out and work for a few years first in the industry. Then getting this industry experience, then you can come and teach the IHL and share your experience.
You mentioned that that you did a master's degree in NTU. Mm. So what made you choose to go to NTU compared to, let's say, going to another overseas uni or going to any other form of professional training? Yeah, what made you choose NTU?
Master's degree, NTU is very heavily sponsored by Singaporean, for Singaporean. And then it's very cheap, and then it's affordable, and then it's recognized, NTU. Like NUS, they also have, but they have a different area of expertise.
Mm.
I think in NUS, they have like a mastery in pharmacies, but I'm not a pharmacist, right? So that time, I actually screened through a few course, then I choose NTU.
What was the course name in NTU? What was the degree called?
Master's in life science.
Life science.
Yeah, so the name is very nice because it's very general, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so sometimes, just advice to all of you, when you want to apply a course, the name is very important, you know? If the name is too niche or too specific, you know, then, you know, sometimes that when you apply a job, then they will ask, what do you study? It seems to be so niche. So that's why I always tell the young adult, tell y'all that, don't worry if you get to this diploma. You know, like even you get to vet tech, doesn't mean you end up in your vet. I already told you, diploma is only a foundation. Okay, start the real life where you go for degree, right? So if you can get into a degree in NUS, the degree in life science, that is good because it's a very general one. Then from there, you want to take your honors or take your master's or PhD, then you get into the specific area you like. Yeah, honestly, I tell you, when you're looking for a job, people don't bother which poly you come from already because they will look at your highest qualification. I think two highest qualification. So example for me, they will look at my master's and my bachelor degree. And sometimes they don't even look at my transcript from DP, you know.
If you weren't teaching or if you weren't working in this field of marine conservation, what else would you be doing?
Probably I would set up my own business. Yeah, set up our own business, maybe open a few cafes. You know, or bubble tea. Yeah, I see a lot of people queuing, like that. Yeah, something like that. Now F&B lah, maybe in F&B business lah, in business. Doing my own business. So if I'm not, teaching. Yeah.
Lastly, do you have any advice for your younger self?
Education is important, but sometimes we don't take things so seriously. I think the most important thing is to be happy. As long as your heart is happy, the things that you do will be very smooth. You know, have an open heart, right? Don't don't over hold something, you know, it's so strong on your hands, and then you get so stressed out. In the end, you cannot even do a single thing. Enjoy your learning, enjoy the process, enjoy knowing your friends in poly. This is very true, because I still have once a month gathering with my Temasek poly friends, which I graduate. And when they know that I'm teaching there, they all shock and look at my eyes, you know. Yeah, so cherish the moment that you have, you make your friends in the poly, because these are your friends that go through with you up and downs for 3 years. Okay, maybe 2 years, just third year, some of you go to your specialty, right? Yeah, so these are the things that, I would advise.
Thank you, Mr. Oliver, for coming here and spend time with us.
Thank you, guys. I wish you all the best. I wish you all don't get it, your success, okay? Get the things that you all need and dream come true. Thank you.
Yeah, wish you well. You're a fun lecturer.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching this episode of Dear Younger Me. We hope you have learned more about the educator profession. If you enjoyed this video, remember to like it and subscribe to our YouTube channel, where we'll be posting more videos about other professions.